privilege and opportunity to worship with you this Sabbath morning.
Amen.
I want to thank Elder Victor for inviting me. He's God's point man, and I respect him highly as a young man of God.
Amen.
I went to school with his wife, former Leanne Graves, in Trinidad. And this morning I saw that she's heavy with child. And she's due in September. So we definitely look forward to that. And your pastor, Pastor Hayden, I was privileged to have his father as my pastor at Emmanuel Brinklow. This is the 1980s. And your father, I have great respect for him as a man of God and as a preacher. Very powerful preacher. Has he been here?
Yes.
Very powerful preacher and one of the most articulate men I know. Very articulate, extremely articulate. And I have tremendous respect for him. In fact, I saw him a couple of weeks ago. He was eating in the GC cafeteria. I also want to acknowledge Vester and Karen Banner. We work at the GC together. I want to thank you for coming out. I want to give a little background on the talk I'm going to present today. How many of you have heard of William Foy? Who have heard of William Foy? There was a myth perpetuated, we believe, by the first Adventist historian named John Loughborough. Now, this is kind of bittersweet because Loughborough did much to bring attention to William Foy, but he also got some of the facts wrong. And for the longest time, it was believed that William Ellis Foy was a black man in the 1840s who had visions from God. And that instead of sharing his visions, that he refused to obey God's call. And as a result, he sickened and died. In fact, in the 1840s, during the height of the Millerite period, it was believed that God gave visions to a trilogy of people, three people, that represented the United States' major demographic at the time: a black man, a white man, and a woman. Now, the black man's name was, of course, William Foy. And who was the white man? Hazen Foss. And what's the story on him? They say he refused to obey. He refused to obey, and he had visions, and God told him to share his visions, but he refused. And then later he relented and he said, "I will tell what I've seen." And he got up in a gathering similar to this, and what happened? He said, "I can't remember what I was shown." And they say from that moment on he was a lost man. Now, of course, we don't know if that's true, but from then on, he never showed any more interest in religion. Now, who was the third person who God blessed with the prophetic gift? Right. Ellen Harmon, who became Ellen White. When my father was a seminary student at Andrews in the late 1970s, he encountered what I call the Foy myth, that Foy was a black man who rejected the call. And he decided to look deeper into it. So in the late 70s and into the 80s, he did research on this man named William Foy. And what he discovered was that Foy was indeed faithful to God's call. And that when God showed him these great visions, that Foy shared them with thousands of people. And that he was one of the key heralds of Jesus' second coming. And he produced a book in 1987 called The Unknown Prophet. How many of you have heard of that book, The Unknown Prophet? Recently, it was re-released. And we were thinking about calling it the more known prophet, or the no longer unknown prophet. But it's been re-released, and I encourage you definitely to pick that up. If for some reason, financially, you can't pick it up, I encourage you to go to the website, blacksdahistory.org. How many of you have been there? blacksdahistory.org. If you have an iPad, you can go there right now. I won't hold it against you. iPad or a smartphone. This is the only website on Black SDA history. And when I say black, I'm talking about black people wherever they are found. I would encourage you to go there, and please send feedback. Any questions you have, any additions you would make to the website, we would love to hear from you. And we want to make Adventist history and black history, we want the knowledge of that to spread all over the world, what do you say? Amen. This is indeed the 150th anniversary of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, what do we mean when we say 150? What happened 150 years ago? Okay, the name, that's a good... It's a good guess. The name was actually adopted in 1861, so you're 2 years off, but we won't hold that against you. What happened in 1863? What happened in the nation? Does anyone know? 1863. The Emancipation Proclamation, right? January 1, 1863. Abraham Lincoln signed into law, effectively, at least on the books, freeing black captives. But what happened in the church? Does anyone know? On May 21, 1863, the General Conference was officially voted into existence. That's when the General Conference was officially incorporated. So we mark that as the beginning of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, we're not calling the 150 years, we're not calling it a celebration. We're calling it a commemoration. Because it's kind of bittersweet, right? Because you could say it a number of ways. I'm told that in Mandarin Chinese, that you can say the same thing, but you can inflect differently, and it means different things. So on one aspect, you can say, we're still here. And then another aspect, you can say, we're still here. Jesus hasn't come yet. Someone told me the other day, she was about 21 years old. And she said, I'm actually glad that Jesus hasn't come because I wouldn't have been born. I don't know what to say about that. What do you say to that? Anyhow, I want to give you this morning the life story of William Ellis Foy. And as much as possible, I've tried to keep my own views and my own interpretations out of the story. Because I want you to hear this man's story, because this is Men's Day, and this is a man of tremendous stature to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, to religious history, and to the cause of God. And so I want you to listen to this, and like one of the parables of Jesus, I'm not going to add any interpretation. It's up to you to interpret it, and once I'm done with this life story, I'm going to sit down, and I'm sure Pastor Hayden will come up after me and give him a few. William Ellis Foy was born in a rural setting just north of Augusta, Maine in 1818. to African-American parents, Joseph and Elizabeth Foy. Frederick Douglass was born the same year of 1818, not far from here in Talbot County, Maryland. Foy was born free, but Douglass was a slave. At that time, the plight of millions of other Americans of African descent. As was often the case during the period, the Foys lived among a small collective of black families, making a living by farming a modest plot of land they owned. Although scant little is known of William's early life, it was most likely consumed with helping run the family farm and associating with the children of other black families in the area. When William was 15, his family moved to nearby Palermo, Maine. Frequent visits to the capital city of Augusta brought the teenager into contact with Silas Curtis, a local Free Will Baptist minister. Now, Curtis was a white man, but he was an active abolitionist and a highly respected pastor who saw no barriers of race when it came to the Gospel Commission. Foy writes that, under the preaching of Elder Silas Curtis, I was led to inquire, what should I do to be saved? In response, and I'm quoting, Christians directed me to the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Foy gives us a glimpse into his internal spiritual struggles when he writes, quote, I then began to pray earnestly to God to pardon my sins, but the more I prayed, the more I beheld the sinfulness of my heart. And for many days I feared there was no mercy for me, but was led to see that it would have been justice for God to have cut me off and sent me where hope or mercy could not have reached me. When William understood exactly what he deserved, then understood that there was indeed mercy for him in Jesus, he became willing to give up all. I'm quoting, and in that moment, Christ appeared the one altogether lovely and the chiefest among 10,000s. I then rejoiced in the God of my salvation, while all things around me appeared new, shining forth the glory of God. I then saw such a fullness of Christ that I wanted to proclaim it to all the world. Oh, the glory of God that filled my soul. 3 months rolled away in which I enjoyed sweet communion with my God. But interrupting William's month-long joy came a trial by those who should have been nursing fathers in Israel. And we don't know exactly who this trial was. But this trial led William to more struggles in prayer. By way of an answer to these prayers, another father in Israel gave me instruction that proved a blessing to my soul. The Christians had directed him to the Lamb of God. Then some of them betrayed him. Then one of them led him back. Like growing up among a community of rural blacks, so Foy was a communal Christian, for better or for worse, casting his lot with the saints of the Free Will Baptist Church. Foy accepted wise advice from another father in Israel and became fully integrated into the life of the church. He reports that he joined the Sabbath school and there learned how to read a small Bible that he owned. This is, of course, significant, not only because Foy learned of God through Bible reading, but because black slaves in the South were explicitly forbidden to learn how to read. Literacy for William was a means to get closer to God. Impressed by God that he needed to be baptized, for 3 months, Foy was disobedient, repeatedly putting it off. Finally, he gives in and is baptized by his pastor, Silas Curtis. And I want you to listen to Foy describe the experience. While coming up out of the water, it appeared to me the opening heavens around me shone. And I cried with a loud voice, saying, "Glory to God and the Lamb that sitteth upon the throne." What does that sound like? The next year or so, around 1836, William married a woman named Anne. Her last name is not known. The couple had their first child, Amelia, the next year. The Foys relocated to Boston in 1840, residing in the historic Beacon Hill district. There, Foy set out to obtain Episcopalian clergy credentials and learn the trade to support his family. The Boston years were filled with the budding preacher filling speaking engagements in the many churches in the bustling city. Shortly after his move to Boston, Foy became acquainted with the teaching of William Miller that Jesus was soon to return to the earth. But he either rejected the whole doctrine or, more likely, the nearness aspect. For he wrote later, "I was opposed to the doctrine of Jesus' near approach." At this point in time, many Millerite preachers claim that Jesus was to come in a matter of a few years. And soon, William Miller himself joined those ministers, believing that humankind only had a matter of months on this earth. The 12th Street Baptist Church was a black congregation in the heart of Boston in Beacon Hill, just several blocks from where the Foys lived. The pastor, George Black, was present, as well as a physician named Dr. Henry Cummins, William's wife Anne, and eight others whose names were recorded as witnesses. This is how William Foy describes the experience. And I'm quoting, "I met with the people of God, where the Christians were engaged in solemn prayer, and my soul was made happy in the love of God. I was immediately seized as in the agonies of death, and my breath left me. And it appeared to me that I was a spirit separate from the body. I then beheld one arrayed in white raiment, whose countenance shone beyond the brightness of the stars, and a crown was upon his head, which shone above the brightness of the sun." Foy was in vision for 2.5 hours, during which time Dr. Cummins examined him, but could find no appearance of life except around the heart. What William Foy saw that day, over 170 years ago, is breathtaking. An angelic God, adorned in white raiment, whose countenance shone beyond the brightness of the stars, guided him through this first vision and subsequent visions. In exquisite detail, Foy was shown heaven and the travails those who reach there must pass through, as well as the fate of those who fall away. Most amazingly, Foy got a good look at Jesus in heaven. I want you to listen to his description, because how often do you get to hear someone describe Jesus physically? "I then beheld, as it were, a great gate before me. The gate was so tall, the height thereof I was unable to see. Before the gate stood a tall and mighty angel, clothed in raiment pure and white. His eyes were like flaming fire, and he wore a crown upon his head, which lighted up the boundless plain. The angel raised his hand and laid hold upon the gate and opened it, and as it rolled upon its glittering hinges, he cried with a loud voice to the heavenly host, 'You are all welcome.'" Now, what does this sound like? It sounds like John's description of Jesus in Revelation 1 doesn't. Even to the point of Jesus says, I have set before you an open door, and only I can open it and close it. Later in the vision sequence, William saw Jesus again, describing our Lord this way. At the right side of the mountain appeared a mighty angel with raiment like a burnished gold. His legs were like pillars of flaming fire. His countenance was like lightning, and his crown gave light to this boundless place. And those that had not passed through death could not look upon his countenance. I then beheld upon the side of the mount letters like pure gold, which said the Father and the Son. Directly under these letters stood the mighty angel, whose crown lighted up the place, and all the heavenly host worshiped at his feet, round about the mountain. The mighty angel then raised his right hand, which appeared like a flaming sword, and all the multitude of those that had not passed through death were caught up on the top of the mountain. Descriptions of heaven abound in this revelation, rich in description and symbolism. I'm quoting, the inside of the gate appeared like glittering diamonds. Beneath our feet was as the appearance of pure glass. I then beheld countless millions of shining ones coming with cards in their hand. And I always like it because Foy is always talking about how many people there are in heaven. Amen? These shining ones became our guides. The cards they bore shone above the brightness of the sun, and they placed them in our hands. But the names of them I could not read. These guides took us by the right hand and led us into a boundless place. Then I lifted up my eyes and looked above. No clouds or sky appeared, but there are countless of millions of bright angels whose wings were like the pure gold. And they sung with loud voices while their wings cried, holy, holy. Yeah. Foy then saw two groups in heaven. Those who had passed through death and those who hadn't passed through death. Next, he beheld in the midst of this boundless place a high mountain likened to pure silver. It appeared perfectly round, and around this mountain was a space in which stood no being. But after this vacant circle stood, as it appeared to be, a choir of angels, and as far as my sight could extend, throughout this boundless place stood countless millions of the righteous. Stood countless millions of the righteous. And oh, the singing no mortal can describe. In this vision, William also vividly saw the fate of the wicked in hell. I'm quoting, I then beheld this lower world, wrapped as it were in rolling mountains of flame. And in this fire, I saw a countless multitude crying for mercy. They appeared to be the aged and those that had come to the years of understanding. Now let me interject something here about the aged, which I believe is a metaphor. Those in heaven are eternally young and youthful, while those in hell are still subject to aging. Continuing, their cries came up before the mountain, while all the heavenly host were bowed in solemn stillness. Now this, of course, distressed Foy, who had a shepherd's heart. And he asked his guide, why is there no mercy for those whom I have seen in distress? And his guide answered, the gospel has increased in them, and the servants have warned them, but they would not believe. And when the great day of God's wrath comes, there will be no mercy for them. Foy's vision concludes with him once again in paradise. Listen to this. Where on the sea of glass, countless millions of the righteous stand with crowns on their heads. boy sees a tree which everyone has plucked fruit. His guide says, those that eat of the fruit of this tree return to earth no more. And what do you think William did? He raises his hand to take a piece of the fruit that I might no more return to earth. And suddenly, I immediately found myself again in this lonely vale of tears. When William came out of vision, his wife testified that the first appearance of life I saw in him was the raising of his right hand. He then arose upon his knees. And by the way, Ellen White speaks a lot about William Foy's wife, Ann Foy, and about how the dynamics between the two of them when William Foy was sharing his vision. She says that he made signs for water, which was given him. He dipped his hand into it and wet his forehead, and his speech immediately came to him. We then wished him to tell us what things he had seen, and he answered, as soon as I receive strength, I will reveal unto you that which the Lord has revealed unto me. Whether William Foy shared his vision with the gathering after he regained his strength is not known. What we do know is that shortly after the whole experience, Foy sank into depression and despondency, feeling that he should share what he had seen, but not doing so. This is one of the reasons that I really appreciate Foy's story, because he was always disobeying, but he ultimately obeyed what he said.
Amen.
He writes, I was disobedient, settling upon this point for an excuse that my God did not command me so to do, and I thereby brought darkness and death upon my soul, but I can find no peace or comfort. I begin to doubt whether indeed my soul had been converted, and although I often met with the people of God, I obtained no relief, but felt distressed and lonely. I could get no access in prayer. To alleviate this desperate state, Foy wrote down his vision and had it published at one of Boston's main printing shops. But alas, he was unsatisfied with the finished product and remained miserable. 3 weeks later, on Friday, February 4, 1842, at the African Methodist Episcopal Church, what do you say? This is a story about Africans. Foy again went into vision. This time the sanctuary was standing room only. And Foy, giving up the seat to a friend, says, I immediately fell to the floor and knew nothing about this body until 12 hours and a half had passed away, as I was afterward informed. How many of you have slept for 12 and a half hours? Recall that in his last vision, Foy had asked his guide, why is there no mercy for those whom I see in distress? And I believe that this lengthy second vision answers this question in depth. A flaming bar of fire appears in the heavens. And Foy writes, innumerable multitudes came from the four quarters of the earth and were assembled before this bar. And there it stood in solemn silence while paleness gathered on all the countenances. Meanwhile, the saints were glorified and passed through the bar of fire, while the wicked watched, unable to pass. The world beneath appeared to be wrapped in darkness and fire. Into this, the wicked sunk from my sight, crying for mercy. I beheld mothers with their infants in their arms come to the flaming bar. The bodies of the infants became like transparent gold, and on wings of flaming fire, they passed the bar, singing with lovely voices. And the unholy mothers crying for mercy would sink below. Foy is escorted into paradise with the saints and beholds some of the glories of heaven again. Provocatively, Foy saw Pastor George Black. Do you remember him? Whose church he had had his first vision in heaven. It was encouraging for him to see this man of God in heaven. And I might add that George Black was black. At the close of the vision, Foy's guide told him, "Thy spirit must return to yonder world, and thou must reveal those things which thou hast seen, and also warn thy fellow creatures to flee from the wrath to come." I then answered him, saying, "How can I return to yonder world?" He answered me, "I will go with thee and support and help thee to declare these things unto the world." Then I answered the angel, "I will go." As a side note, 2 weeks after this vision, Elder George Black died. His wife, Mary, testified that his dying words were, "I see the chariots coming to walk my spirit home." He then left the world with a shout. Also, after these visions, Foy embraced the teaching of the nearness of Christ's coming. The visions gave him an unshakable faith in what was to him a very blessed hope, with the unspeakable and vast glories of heaven inspiring him. William was told that he must share his vision and had promised his guide that he would do it. But, he writes, "Notwithstanding the command of my guide and my solemn promise to declare these things to the world, I was at first exceedingly unwilling to do so, and it was 3 days before I revealed them in public manner." Why was Foy so unwilling to share his visions? He said the message was so different. I'm sure even now some of you are thinking this, what is this guy talking about? And the manner in which the command was given, so different from any I'd ever heard. And knowing the prejudice against those of my color, it became very crossing. These questions were continually arising. Why should these things be given to me to bear to the world and not to the learned or to one of a different condition other than myself? But no peace could I obtain in disobedience. Woe is me if I declare not these things rested heavily upon my soul. What a struggle, what a commission. Just south of the Mason-Dixon line, millions of Foy's racial counterparts were subject to the cruelest bondage. In the North, there was also fierce racism, just minus the enslavement. Add to this Foy's relative youth. He was 23 or 24 at the time the guide told him to share the vision. And his insecurity about his education. Only just years before he had learned how to read. 4 days after the second vision, J.B. Husted, pastor of the nearby Broomfield Street Church, visited Foy with several of his parishioners. His request was straightforward. "Tell our church what you have seen." Foy agreed, and they arranged that he speak the following afternoon. After they left, though, Foy regretted his decision, thinking that had the world been mine, it would cheerfully be given to have the appointment recalled. As the time approached to go to Broomfield Street, temptations began to sorely afflict me. I feared lest my guide would not be with me, and I should be unable to tell the people the things which had been shown me, which we know was a very realistic fear because the same thing happened to Hazen Foss. But Foy's willingness is what saved him, for he was escorted to the church by a band of brethren who perceptibly discerned his struggle. When he entered, a large group greeted him, and, as he descriptively puts it, each individual seemed like a mountain. In a last-ditch effort, the terrified Foy asked Pastor Husted to begin the meeting with prayer, hoping that the occasion would turn into a prayer meeting and he would be relieved of his duty. But as the pastor prayed, Foy heard a voice say, "I am with thee, and I promise to be with thee." At that moment, my heart then began to burn within me. The fear of man suddenly fled, and unspeakable glory filled my soul. William proceeded to share his visions so eloquently and so powerfully that subsequently he was inundated with requests to speak. His calendar booked months in advance. John Hofburg, the first historian of Seventh-day Adventism, has this to say about William Foy. In the year 1842, there was living in Boston, Massachusetts, a well-educated mulatto by the name of William Foy, who was an eloquent speaker. He was a Baptist, but was preparing to take holy orders as an Episcopal minister. The Lord graciously gave him two visions in the year 1842, one on the 18th of January and the other on February 4. These visions bore clear evidence of being genuine manifestations of the Spirit of God. He was invited from place to place to speak in the pulpits, not by Episcopalians only, but by Baptists and other denominations. When he spoke, he always wore the clergyman's robe, such as the ministers of that church wear in their services. Mr. Foy's visions related to the near advent of Christ, the travels of the people of God in the heavenly city, the new earth, and the glories of the redeemed state. Having a good command of language with fine descriptive powers, he created a sensation wherever he went. By invitation, he went from city to city to tell the wonderful things he had seen. And in order to accommodate the vast crowds who assembled to hear him, large halls were secured, where he related to thousands what had been shown him of the heavenly world, the loveliness of the New Jerusalem, and of the angelic hosts. When dwelling on the tender, compassionate love of Christ for poor sinners, he exhorted the unconverted to seek God, and scores responded to his entreaties. What do you say?
Amen.
Of this time of touring and relating his vision, Foy writes, "I traveled 3 months delivering my message to crowded houses, enjoying continual peace." After 3 months of constant speaking, fearing that his family was not being provided for adequately, Foy did manual labor for another 3 month period, but could find no rest day nor night until again I consented to my duty. Foy commenced touring, attesting that although he suffered persecution, his guide was with him. Now listen to this. This is a piece, an editorial in a newspaper in Portland, Maine, called the Portland Tribune. That was the main newspaper in the city, of February 10, 1844. And this editorial illustrates the type of racial persecution that Foy underwent. I want you to listen to this. It's called, "When Will Wonders Cease?" When will wonders cease? The Millerites of this city have recently imported a great bull nigger who has been rolling up the whites of his eyes, showing his ivory, those are his teeth, and astonishing the good people by his dreams and prognostications. It is said that the fat and greasy black can neither read nor write, but he told of the joys of the blessed and the wailings of the damned with such gusto that even the weakest disciple of the prophet smacked his lips for more. What will be the end of these things we cannot divine? We soon expect to see this fat bull nigger, superbly dressed, seated in a chariot, and drawn through our streets by the devoted disciples of Miller, who will bow down and worship him as God. Articles like this prove that William Foy was neither paranoid nor delusional for fearing racial animosity toward him in speaking engagements. Nor was he exaggerating when he reported that he suffered persecution, racial persecution, after he began lecturing. That this piece would be featured in the official newspaper of a racially progressive and tolerant city like Portland, Maine, is telling. William Foy had a third and fourth vision. And by the way, who lived in Portland, Maine at the time? Who lived in Portland, Maine? Right, the Harmon family, Ellen White and her family. William Foy had a third and fourth vision, probably in the summer of 1844, which we know from the recollections of Loughborough and Ellen White. Loughborough conveyed that the third vision was of three steps, and he also calls them platforms, that Foy referred to as steps of fire, leading up to a pathway. On the first step was a great multitude of people, many of whom dropped and disappeared in an instant to be seen no more. And of these, it was said, apostatized, while those that remained advanced to the second step. Of the remaining, more disappeared on the second step, and the remainder advanced to the third step. Those who remained on the third step and did not disappear went into the city of God. A great company then gathered with those who had advanced to this platform. Speaking to Seventh-day Adventists, half a century later, Loughborough said, in another vision, Foy saw a mighty angel come down from heaven, and a voice cried and said, "This angel has yet three steps to take." Foy didn't understand anything about it, but is there anyone here today who doesn't know what that means? He lived to hear Sister Harmon relate her first vision and to testify that the two were identical. Now, of course, what did Loughborough and others believe that the three steps meant? Can you guess? Yeah, the three angels' messages. Seventh-day Adventists came to believe that after the great disappointment, that the three angels' messages still had to be proclaimed to the entire world. And we still believe that, right? We still have that work to do. Loughborough was correct in asserting that Foy did not understand the vision, as is evidenced by him not including it in a booklet he published recounting his visions. The content of the fourth vision is unknown, although, as we shall see, Ellen White insisted that William Foy had four visions. Around the middle of 1842, the Foys moved to Portland, Maine, the city where Ellen White's family lived. It was during this time that Ellen White and her family first heard William Foy. In a 1906 interview with her assistant Doris Robinson, White distinctly recalled Foy, which is remarkable, saying it was six decades later. And I want you to listen as I read this interview. Ellen White says, "Then another time, there was Foy that had visions." And some of his language may sound choppy because this is an interview and it's transcribed. "He had four visions. He was in a large congregation, very large. He fell right to the floor. I do not know what they were doing in there, whether they were listening to preaching or not. But at any rate, he fell to the floor. I do not know how long he was down, about three quarters of an hour, I think. And he had all these visions before I had them." This is Ellen White talking. "They were written out and published, and it is queer that I cannot find them in any of my books. But we have moved so many times." By this time, Ellen White had moved dozens of times. He had four. The interviewer asked her, "Did you ever have an interview with him?" And my wife responded, "I had an interview with him. He wanted to see me, and I talked with him a little. They had appointed for me to speak that night, and I did not know that he was there. I did not know at first that he was there. While I was talking, I heard a shout. And he is a great, tall man. And the roof was rather low. And he jumped right up and down. And oh, he praised the Lord. He praised the Lord. It was just what he had seen. Just what he had seen. But they extolled him, so I think it hurt him. And I do not know what became of him." His wife was so anxious. She sat looking at him. This is Ellen White talking. So that it disturbed him. Pastor, has that ever happened to you? You're preaching, your wife's looking at you and kind of throws you off. "Now," said he, "you must not get where you can look at me when I'm speaking." He had an Episcopalian robe. His wife sat by the side of me. This is a young Ellen White. We're talking 14 or 15 years old. So Ann Foy was sitting next to Ellen White. She kept moving about and putting her head behind me. What did she keep moving about so for? We found out when he came to his wife. "I did as you told me," said she. "I hid myself. I did as you told me." She would be so anxious repeating the words right after him with her lips. So he's up there speaking. She's repeating what he's saying. He's like, "Don't do that." So she's trying to hide her face so she won't do it. Obviously, she was a warrior and she cared about her husband. After the meeting was ended and he came to look her up, she said to him, "I hid myself. You didn't see me." He was a very tall man, slightly colored. You recall that John Lothrow said he was a mulatto. But, Ellen White says, it was remarkable testimonies that he bore. It was remarkable testimonies that he bore. "I always sat right close by the stand. I know what I sat there for now. It hurt me to breathe." You remember her health issues? "It hurt me to breathe. And with all the breaths all around me, I knew I could breathe easier right by the stand. So I always took my station." Robinson asks her, "Then you attended the lectures that Mr. Foy gave?" She says, "He came to give it right to the hall, in the great hall where we attended, Beethoven Hall. That was quite a little time after the visions. It was in Portland, Maine. We went over to Cape Elizabeth to hear him lecture. Father always took me with him when he went. And he would be going in a sleigh. And he would invite me to get in, and I would ride with him. That was before I got in any way acquainted with him." She's speaking of Ford. Robinson says, "Where did you see him first?" Ellen White responds, "It was there at Beethoven Hall. They lived near the bridge where we went over to Cape Elizabeth, the family did." One suspects that Foy had a significant influence on the teenage Ellen Harmon during these her formative years. Before she herself experienced the prophetic gift, she saw this charismatic young black man effectively sharing his visions and winning souls to Christ. All of this under tough circumstances, not unlike the hurdles of age, gender, lack of education, and ill health that she would have to overcome herself to be an effective spokesperson for God. She also owned a copy of his booklet detailing his visions that he would later publish. Further, her initial visions bear striking similarity to Foy's, as he enthusiastically made clear when the two switched roles after the great disappointment, and Foy listened to her speak of her visions. So she went to hear him speak about his visions, and after the great disappointment, he went to hear her speak. Finally, the Millerites, who became Seventh-day Adventists, saw the ignition of the spirit of prophecy in the life of William Ford as a proof that the 2300-day prophecy of Daniel 8:14 was approaching its fulfillment. This was faith strengthening to the Millerite Ellen Harmon. In 1845, William Foy collaborated with two fellow Millerite brothers, John and Charles Pearson, who later would become minor pioneers in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And they published a 24-page pamphlet called The Christian Experience of William E. Foy, in which Foy shares his conversion experience and then describes his first two visions. If you Google it, or go to blacksdahistory.org, you can download a copy of The Christian Experience, and you can read the visions that I've shared with you. The brothers Pearson prefaced the booklet with several pages proving that God speaks to men in dreams and visions. He spoke to the patriarchs and prophets this way, and to Stephen, and Paul, and John. This is interesting. Listen to this. God continued to give revelations after the canonical period, most notably to the African women Perpetua and Felicitas. This is what the Caucasian Pearson brothers are writing. And to one William Tennant, a Presbyterian clergyman in 1806, considering Foy to be the latest in the grand continuum of seers, the Pearsons wrote, "The visions of our brother are certainly very remarkable." Doesn't that sound familiar? Who said that? Ellen White. And she said that she had the booklet. And when related by him in public assemblies, have been blessed by God to the awakening of sinners, reclaiming of backsliders, and the building up of the saints in the most holy faith. They are published as nearly as possible in his own language. There is a most beautiful resemblance in the views here given with the visions of Ezekiel, Daniel, and John. That the despised and humble few who are patiently waiting for the appearing of the glorious King may be refreshed and comforted in this hour of trial while perusing these two visions is the fervent prayer of the publishers. On the last page is the testimonial of 10 individuals vouching for the authenticity of Foy's visions, as well as a copy of his certificate of church membership, which were persuasive bona fides of the day. It is significant that Foy published this booklet after the great disappointment, indicating a continued commitment to the second coming of Jesus and to the encouragement of the broken believers. William Foy had been disappointed with the other Millerites, William Foy, Joshua Hines, Joseph Bates, Ellen and James White, J.N. Andrews, but he didn't give up his faith as thousands of other Millerites did when Jesus did not appear on the appointed day. Instead, he sought to encourage the disappointed. He frankly states the object of the publication near its conclusion. He writes, "My object in publishing these visions is to comfort the saints." His attendance at a gathering in 1845, where Ellen Harmon spoke about her visions, also bears out this commitment. The man who once opposed the doctrine of Jesus' near coming was now a leader and comforting and strengthening the dashed, woebegone believers. What effect did Foy's visions have on him personally? Obviously, the individual who has experienced God's powerful nearness through the prophetic gift is heavily impacted. They say that once you receive visions, you will never be the same, whether for better or for worse, you won't be the same. Foy's visions, of course, brought perplexity and distress at first. Sharing them brought a measure of fame, but also persecution. Yet after the disappointment of 1844, after Foy was by all accounts finished lecturing on them, at least at the rate he had been, he expressed what they meant to him personally. He says, "They, speaking of the visions, have been a great consolation to me in seasons of temptation and trial. Then in deeply moving prose, Foy writes, "Often in the silent hours of the night, I have seemed to hear again the sweet song of the angels. And whenever my heart has felt sad and lonely, the things shown me by the angel have lifted me above the trying scenes of the earth." And thus was the Millerite era for William Foy. After 1845, as far as is known, he lost contact with those who would eventually become Seventh-day Adventists: Ellen Harmon, the Pearsons, and John Loughborough. Loughborough thought that Foy had sinned and died after 1844. But Foy actually lived five more decades, continuing his ministry, albeit on a smaller stage, taking residence alternately in New Bedford, Massachusetts, and the main towns of Chelsea, Burnham, Mount Desert Island, and East Sullivan. Foy pastored interracial and predominantly white Baptist congregations. In a regional history of East Sullivan, lay genealogist Leela Clark Johnson reports that in the community, Foy was esteemed and beloved as a minister who held religious meetings in various places. William Foy ultimately had three children: Amelia, Loretta, and Orrin. And by the way, there's no extant image or photograph of William Foy, but we do have a photograph of his son, Orrin. Foy had two more wives, not simultaneously, I might add. Caroline Griffin, who he's married to from 1851 to 1858, and Parsentia Rose, 1870 to 1873. Tragically, Foy endured frequent and intimate losses. His wife, Anne, and father died around 1850. His second wife, Caroline, died in the late 1850s. His seven-year-old daughter, Loretta, died in 1863. And his mother died in 1870. At some point in his later life, I'm closing, William Foy penned this poem called "Egypt's Land." "When I was down in Egypt's land, I heard my Savior was at hand. And the midnight cry was sounding, and I wanted to be free. So I left my former brethren to sound the jubilee. They said that I had better stay and go with them in their own way. But they scoffed at my Lord's power. With them I could not agree. So I left their painted synagogues to sound the jubilee. They call us now a noisy crew and say they hope we'll soon get through. But we are now growing stronger, both in love and unity, since we left old mystic Babylon to sound the jubilee. When Satan comes to tempt your minds, then meet him with these blessed lines, saying, 'Get behind me, Satan. I have naught to do with thee. I have got my soul converted, and I'll sound the jubilee.'" The battle is not to the strong. The weak shall sing the conqueror's song. I've been through the fiery furnace, and no harm was done to me. I came out with stronger evidence to sound the jubilee. I like that poem. What do you say? Brother could write, man. A year before Foy died, John Loughborough published the first history of Seventh-day Adventists called "Rise and Progress of the Seventh-day Adventists." In it, he gives Foy a prominent place as a prophet who brought thousands to the Lord and ushered in the end of the 2100-day period. Similarly, at the beginning of the year of Foy's death in 1893, John Loughborough spoke to Adventist leaders and members the 30th General Conference session in Battle Creek, Michigan, on the leading of God and the prophetic Advent movement. How many of you have been to a General Conference? You know that that's the official time of Adventists worldwide to meet. And so here John Loughborough is speaking the year of William Foy's death about William Foy. This is what he says. God began to manifest the gift of prophecy in the first message. That's the first angel's message. Before the time passed, as early as 1842. William Foy of Boston. I want you to imagine the General Conference session with all the believers there. I believe this year is in the Dime Tabernacle in Meadow Creek. William Foy of Boston was given three visions showing the pathway of the Advent people, and he went from place to place relating them. He saw the people being brought on to three different platforms, one following another. Some dropped through the first and went out of sight, and the others went on to the second one. Some dropped through this and disappeared, and the remainder went to the third. Still others disappeared through this, and then the remainder went on to the city of God. In another vision, he saw a mighty angel come down from heaven, and a voice cried and said, "This angel hath yet three steps to take." You've heard this before. Foy didn't understand anything about it. But is there anyone here today who doesn't know what that means? He lived to hear Sister Harmony relate her first vision, and then testified that the two were identical. Do you understand how compelling this is? Seventh-day Adventists recognize William Foy. This is at a general conference. I want to impress upon you that whatever is said by a church official at a general conference is official. Seventh-day Adventists recognize William Foy as manifesting the coveted spirit of prophecy and saw his ministry as a proof of the 2300-day prophecy's fulfillment. In 1905, an updated edition of the first history of the Advent movement, Loughborough wrote, "Brother Foy's work continued until the year 1844, near the close of the 2300-day period. Then he was favored with another manifestation of the Holy Spirit." Loughborough again says, "With such manifestations of the power of God, in connection with the preaching of his coming at the doors, and with the rejoicing of thousands who were turning from sin to serve the Lord and to wait for his coming, the people were doubly assured that this was indeed the Lord's message to the world." Amen. The next year, Ellen White was interviewed about Foy, and as you have heard, also believed that Foy's visions were from God. William Foy died on November 9, 1893, and is buried in the Birch Tree Cemetery in Sullivan, Maine. On his tombstone is chiseled this epitaph: "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me," what? "A crown of righteousness." I close with the last paragraphs of Foy's booklet, Christian Experience. "My desire is the children of God may be blessed by these visions in the same manner that I have been. I am waiting for my coming Lord. Although before the Lord was pleased to show me these heavenly things, I was opposed to the doctrine of Jesus' near approach. I'm now looking for that event. I expect soon to see tall and mighty angel. Then shall I be satisfied when I awaken his likeness. Ye saints of God, lift up your heads, for the glories of the earth made new will soon be yours. I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the hearts of men, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him." What do you say?